Good morning, church. We're glad to see each of you here, to see some new faces, some familiar faces back for the first or second time. And we also thank you and welcome those of you who are joining us online this morning. We are glad that each and every one of you are here. We're glad that we can come together and worship God this morning. And I hope you're as excited about that as I am. And I just want to thank Linda and Jan for the wonderful music this morning. Did you all appreciate that as much as I did? That was great. So looking forward to what God has in store for us during this worship service, and I hope you are too. With that, let's go ahead and start by entering into his courts with a word of prayer. God, thank you so much for who you are and how great and powerful you are. God, we thank you that we can have hope in the midst of crazy times because of you and who you are. And we just ask that you would help us this morning to focus on that, to focus on you as we're singing, as we're listening to the words in your scripture and Pastor Mitch's message this morning, God, that you would just use each and everything we do and say here today to draw each and every one of us closer to you. We ask this in your name we pray. Amen.
People said,
amen.
Well, good morning, church. I'm asked that you would join me in today's responsive reading. As we sang just a moment ago, and as we're going to continue to sing about hope and faith and how important those are in our walk with God. So join with me. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you, I trust, O my God. No one whose hope is in you will ever be put to shame.
My eyes are ever on the Lord.
Show me your way, O Lord, teach me your path. Guide me in your truth.
Teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long.
And all of us. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you I trust, O my God.
Hey, would you please stand and sing, because we really, truly are pressing on for the higher ground.
Lord, lift me up and let me stand.
one thing I've learned through this time, and I hope all of you have learned too, is that our faith is so important to us. And it's what's getting us through. And we can stand on higher ground because we serve a God who is present, who's here, and is ever watching and caring for us. This is a new song, but sing along if you know it or you've heard it.
Praise team, thank you so much. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn to the book of Hebrews chapter 11. Or if you're at home watching online, I, as Tracy, want to greet you and thank you for being a part of our worship service today. As Linda stated, we, over the next few weeks, are going to be looking at the different faces of hope. And you cannot have this conversation without understanding, and we're going to go back to that in a few minutes, how intricately faith and hope work together. This morning we are going to, in Hebrews chapter 11, look at what many call the roll call of the faith. This morning I'm going to read one verse, and then I'm going to jump over to chapter 10, if you'll allow me to, and you'll see how they tie together. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is the assurance of all things hoped for. It is also the conviction of things not yet seen. And this is not going to be on your screen, but I would encourage you to write this down, if you're at home, flip over there real quick. Hebrews chapter 10, the author talks about and lays the stage for a new way of living. Therefore, brethren, since we have confidence to enter the holy place by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way which he has inaugurated, let us, now listen to this, let us through the veil that he has, his flesh, since we have a great high priest in the house of God, let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confessions of our hope without wavering. Father, we thank you for yet another opportunity you give us to come before you. And we would be remiss if we did not pray for so many in the life of our church, God, that are still struggling or are battling with illness or loneliness or simply just the fatigue of everything that the last 6 months has laid before us. Be with them, God. Would you be their portion, their strength? Would they, as they draw close to you, renew their faith and their hope in a confidence that we have that, God, with you, absolutely nothing is impossible. Holy God, we lift up our country and our leaders and our state, and we pray, God, that you would fill them with wisdom and knowledge, that they would sense from you an understanding of what the direction before them needs to be, and how you can, God, and only you, help us accomplish that. Father, I pray for so many that have been affected, whether it's in our body or those that we know, and Father, those that we don't even know across this globe by this virus. God, we believe that you have in some way, shape, or form allowed this to take place to get our attention, and our attention, God, you have. So now that you have your attention, God, would you give us the mind of Christ? Help us see, hear, and understand. Holy God, we love you and we thank you. In Christ's name, join me as we recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
While storms howl above me, and there's no hiding place. Mid the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till a storm passes by.
Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Oh, be fast, let me stand in the hollow of the hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Many times Satan whispered, there is no need to try, for this wind of sorrow, there's no hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow arrives, where the storm never darkens the skies. When the long night has ended, and the storm comes no more, let me stand in thy presence on that bright, peaceful shore. In a land where the tempest never comes, Lord, may I dwell with thee. When the storm passes by, till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Oh, be blessed, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
Praise team. Wow. What a blessing. And I concur with Tracy that all of those that helped make worship possible, Linda, you and Jan and Derek and so many others, thank you for working so hard. And what a blessing it is to be here today with you. I had the most unique visit right before worship this morning. I had gone to the office and I looked up the clock and felt like, man, I'm running a little late. I need to hurry up and get over there. And I was loading my truck up with my briefcase and some other stuff. And a woman walked by, and I glanced out, and I said hello, and she said hello back, but then became very just inquisitive as to who I was. And she said, now, who are you? And I said, well, my name's Mitch McDonald. And I asked her name, and I didn't get it. Okay, she was kind of evasive at that point. But what is awesome is we spent probably 5 minutes of the sweetest conversation about how real and how much God loves us and wants to see us through where we're at today. She asked me, she said, so you're the new pastor? And I said, yes. And again, I'm trying my best to creatively get this gal's name, and that was all for naught. But she did share this with me. she said, I have only been to church once, and I think she said 38 years. Let's just ballpark it to 40. If 38 is good, then 40 is better, okay? But I've only been to church once in the last 38 plus years, and the only time I've been is to your church under the ministry of Pastor Jerry McGee. And she said, what an amazing blessing that was. Now, here's what's interesting. I'm talking to someone who does not want to reveal who they are, who openly knows the lingo. Okay, I mean, what a tremendous blessing it was to be there that day, and she remembered Pastor Jerry's name, and it was really kind of a cool deal. But when I asked her, I said, well, what are you doing this morning? She says, well, I have a walk that I need to finish. And I said, well, what if you did this? What if you walked over to the church and you came to church with us? And in the midst of our conversation, we were talking about the black cloud that seems to be lying on top of us. And I told her, I said, you know, today'd be a good day for you to be there, because we are looking at hope for the frail, the fractured, the flawed. And you don't miss that. Now, there's a passage in Matthew that if you are here today, write that down and go home and read it. Or if you're online, Matthew chapter 12, verses 15 through 21 really was a launching pad for us to get to Hebrews chapter 11 and chapter 10. For sake of time and the weeks that we've allotted to do this series, I want to just encourage you. That's your homework assignment today, okay? Your homework assignment, whether you're online or you're here in person, is to go home and study a little bit of Matthew chapter 12, verses 15 through 21. She knew the language. She clearly knew who we were, but yet, knowing the language, wanting to be able to have a conversation that she was very willing to have, but not willing to make that commitment to worship. Now, that right there, we need to be woken up to. We can know all the right words. We can have all the translations of different passages memorized. And we can even in our heart of hearts know what we need to do. But there does come a point that God mandates. He requires that we worship Him. We cannot ignore that. Not in the midst of disease, not in the midst of fear. And again, I want to go back to that phrase that no matter how frail you might feel, no matter how fractured your life or your spirit or physically you are, and probably for most of us, no matter how flawed we see ourselves, our God is a God of hope. In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, and again, I read the entire chapter. It's absolutely amazing. But what's interesting is we get a picture of how hope and faith work with one another. Now, last week we did this. As we began this series on the faces of hope, we identified and did our best to define those two words. If you weren't here last week, I'm going to bring you up to speed. It's pretty simple. Or if you just logged on and you missed last week, I'd encourage all of you to go back and re-catch last Sunday morning so all the pieces will fit together online. Go to our church website. But we defined hope. Now, that word, we know in the Greek, and if you look at the etymology of it, it's really interesting. You go down into the Latin. We need to remember that Jesus spoke Aramaic. And so all these, and what's great, you can draw a line from these languages, and they all basically have the same etymology. Why is that important? But we're not using different words for different things. We're using one word, and God is consistent. God wants us to have a few things that we can anchor on. And in the midst of life's storms, we can anchor, we can hold on to hope, and we can hold on to faith. Again, in the Greek, the word hope is defined as elpizo. And it's hope is defined in its simplest form as this: to desire something
with confident expectation of its fulfillment. To desire something with a confident expectation of its fulfillment. Now, I read this past week, and I was interested by it. Hope in its purest sense is when you desire something with confident expectation to its fulfillment. But that hope, for the majority, when we are operating and walking in hope, we're walking with that understanding that it's going to be something favorable. I do not hope, now listen to this, I do not hope that this week because perhaps I didn't wear a mask or my gloves were off or I was visiting someone's home, that I don't hope I catch the coronavirus, amen? I mean, that is hope with a negative connotation. Understand, the word still fits. That you can still use that word in defining it. Far too often, though, is we are caught up, and I'll mention this again, we're caught up with a worldly definition of this. Hope for the best, but expect the worst. That's not hope. Now, it might be hope from your perspective of life, but that is not godly hope. So how do we get to that godly hope, Mitch? Well, to do that, we have to understand the building blocks, and this is what we said yesterday or last week. The building block, the main foundation that our hope is built off of, is the reality of faith in God working in our lives. You almost can't separate the two. Again, you look at the etymology, and it's a beautiful journey that you can go on. The Greek word here that's used is pistis, and it's faith is reliance. It's loyalty. It is complete trust in God. Now, I got to tell you, I'd be less than honest with you if I didn't say there's also a sub-definition. Reliance, loyalty, or complete trust in something else. Now, think about that for a second. Think about where we are. We are either in most every area of our life that requires hope, that requires a certain degree of faith for us to step out. We're going to either hope in what the world has to offer us, or we're going to hope in that unseen, beautiful serenity and assurance that God has my back, that God is in control, and that God does not want anything but to provide for me and love me as his child. Now, I didn't say that hope means we get everything we want, did I? Did I say it? No. Hope doesn't mean that we're not every once in a while going to feel the sting of pain, that we're not going to, our hearts won't be broken over grief, that there are all kinds of things that life deals us because we live in a sinful state. But hopefully, if you know Christ as Lord and Savior, you understand you might live in a sinful state, but you're forgiven. You do not have to live just consistently in that lifestyle, but God offers you hope. Mona and I were visiting last night with an acquaintance that unfortunately is getting ready to go through divorce, and his life is in a mess. And I have known him for quite a while, and I've watched over the years how he places hope in many different things. And he's heard me say more than once, man, you got to put your hope in God. You've got to give whatever that is that's broken in your life. You have to release it and let it go, and by faith know that God is going to see you through. We sang about that all day long, that we can know God till the storm passes by. We have hope. We have hope in higher ground. We have hope that my faith will hold. We have hope that my faith looks up to thee. We have hope in the fact, and we honor and proclaim the fact that we have hope because God is holy. The author of Hebrews wanted us to understand this. And if you ever get lost on trying to understand Scripture, if you ever get like, what exactly is being said here? the easiest and most simplistic way you can come to understanding God's word is read a chapter or two before what it said and read a chapter or two after it. Yeah, you can type it in online and go get someone else's opinion, and that's all right, but it is so much better when the Holy Spirit will enlighten us to what this means and what passages mean. And in Hebrews chapter 11, we cannot understand that in its totality unless we reach back into Hebrews chapter 10. But understand that if you do chapter 10 and chapter 11, it's almost a crime to stop without going into Hebrews chapter 12. You have to take all that in kind of one setting, or at least one session that you commit yourself to studying it. I want to go back and I want to draw the stage for Hebrews chapter 11. Again, that's found in Hebrews chapter 10. And write this down, beginning with verse 19. You study that all the way through verses 25. But understand how important these verses are to us as we gather together. For those of you that are watching online, I want you to know that there's not a day that goes by that your church staff and the leaders are not praying that you will physically get healthy enough and that you will feel the comfort enough to come back. We want to worship with you elbow to elbow. Know that. We miss you. For those that are in this room, thank you. Thank you that we didn't show up this morning to just four or five. And don't think that hasn't been a fear every once in a while, okay? But thank you for exercising your faith and exercising your hope and that God is going to take care of us. And that is only found when we understand Hebrews chapter 10. Beginning with verse 22, it says, "Let us draw near with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water." Pretty simple. That's the regenerative process within the new covenant that God's laid out for us, that we have, once we pray to receive Christ as Lord and Savior and we become God's children, that is a definition of who we are right there. If you ever want to figure out who you are in Christ, Hebrews chapter 10. And just commit to memory, verse 22, if nothing else. But you almost can't stop there. You have to go on to verse 23. "Because let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering." I've got to stop there for a second. See, when we waver in our hope, it's almost as if we go back to that definition the world wants us to believe. It's interesting that I didn't have to prod you when I said hope for the best, but expect what? And why do we feel that way? Because that's really what we have been sold by the world, that line of reasoning right there. The world has sold us that you can hope for the best, but chances are you're not going to get to experience the best because the world is so jacked up and promises are never kept, and that goes on and on and on. And as children of God, we have got to draw a line in the sand and say, I am not just going to hope for the best. I can expect the best, not because of who I am, but because of who Christ is in me and what Christ wants to do in my midst. Why he would choose to use a guy like me is beyond me. And if you talk to my family or lifelong friends, it's even further beyond them. I love it when Mona, and it doesn't happen as much anymore, but both of us growing up here in Chandler, and she every once in a while would run into one of our high school friends. And they would begin to chat. "Well, Mona, what have you done with your life? Well, have you married?" "Yes, I've married." "Well, who'd you marry?" And it's almost as if she enjoys this part of the conversation. I'm going to let you know. "I married Mitch McDonald." "Well, is he not in prison?" Now, Mona, don't act like you've not heard that. And now, in those conversations, now is when she gets probably the most tickled because she knows what's going to follow. "Well, what does Mitch do for a living?" "He's a pastor." If they don't drop over and pass out, they get these grandiose ideas of that it must be a ruse, or it must be something that I'd come up with trying to take advantage. But you know, we never, ever, ever need to sell short the difference that God can make in someone's life that openly is willing to say, I am frail, I am fractured both in and out, and most importantly, I am flawed. But I come to God and get forgiveness. And in forgiveness, I find hope. It might not look like there's much you can hold on to or hope to right now. But I promise you that God's word tells us that we can hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. Does the wind of the news blow you around? Does the circumstances that you seem to be in this week, are they a prediction for what next week's going to be like? Or are you willing to say that here's where I'm at this week, and I hope that next week's going to be better? Why? Because I am God's son. I'm sorry. I am God's child. Don't waver in that. Well, then, if I'm not going to waver, how do I get the faith? How do I get the assurance to stand still and not let the winds of life or confusion or heartache or fear or news move me? I remember this. He who promised is faithful. He who promised is faithful. Now, I know for some that might be a little hard to grasp. You've been let down by people. You've been let down maybe through a job or whatever it might be in your life, but you've been let down and it's hard for you to trust any longer in people, much less trust in God if you feel like God's let you down. I just want to remind you of this. He's faithful. And his faith is not tied to the way you view your current circumstance or the way I view my current circumstance. He is faithful, and we're going to talk about this next week, and I'm trying not to get my mind just wants to run there. I'll just say this, that next week we're going to just look at the words to a song that the anchor holds. That if you are anchored in Christ Jesus, that anchor holds. You don't have to worry about it. We are anchored in God, and it's the strongest anchor we can find. I love one of the verses that the praise team sang when it talks about that he hides us in the cleft of the rock. He literally hides us from those things and protects us from the waves that would shatter us. And we're protected. 21 examples of hope and faith in the 11th chapter. He who promised is faithful, and let us consider how to... Now listen to this. This is a job for all of us. Let us consider how to stimulate one another to love and good deeds. Now, don't miss this part. Not forsaking the gathering together, as is the practice of some. For not forsaking our own assembly together, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. I had a church member call me this week, and I don't know what Wednesday night I stated this, but they were watching the Wednesday night Bible studies online, and they said I had made a comment about the second coming of Christ, and I think probably what I did, I flippantly just said, it seems more obvious today than any time in my life that everything is in place for Christ to come home, to come and take us home, I mean. It's in place. And the person I visited with, they kind of struggle with that. And I said, you know what's great about that, and I appreciate your struggle, and I appreciate your questioning, but if they thought it in the New Testament, if they believed, and those that lived in that first century church believed it was going to be imminent, and we look at the Word of God, and we always do this, by the way, never read the newspaper or watch the news without filtering it through God's Word. You just need to do that. But when you read God's Word and you understand what it says about the times that will be taking place when He returns, there'll be a trumpet blast and a shout, and the Scripture tells us the dead in Christ will rise, graves will break open, and those that remain will be caught up with Him in the twinkling of an eye. Now, you can call it any kind of word you want. You can call it rapture. I caution you there that the second coming of the word rapture, by the way, is never mentioned in the Bible, just so you know. That you're not going to find that word in there. You will find the second coming or the return of Christ. But in the midst of living in times that we wonder if our faith will hold, will the anchor hold, we need to understand that we have passages like Hebrews chapter 11. If Hebrews 10 tells us that we need to understand, how are we going to stimulate one another to love and to good deeds? How are we going to stimulate one another to create a safe environment where the army can gather? Not many armies, when they're going out into battle, not many groups will say, let's let that group over there have a plan, and we're going to let these two groups over here have a plan, and then we're just going to blow a whistle and say attack. There'd be no focus. There'd be no direction. There'd be really no testimony of what we've been called to do. So we, as a body of Christ, draw strength when we are together. How do we draw strength? We look over the past and understand what God's Word tells us. 21 examples of people that had hope and faith and how they work together in their lives. I wish we had time. In fact, I was thinking that someday it would be a great either Bible study series or Wednesday night series or small group series on unpacking how these 21 examples honestly showed and exhibited their faith and their hope in God. It'd be awesome. What's really cool about this, and please don't read into this or be offended, but we see everything from heroes to harlots to followers of God. And they all operated. They all exercised faith in what they could not see, but they had within their heart a determination and a confidence that God would bring it to pass. That God would bring that to pass. Just a couple that I think are worth looking at. In these individuals, or these people groups that had faith in what they couldn't see, we see that Abel was one. He offered a better sacrifice. Enoch, Bible says he had faith and pleased God. Noah, building the ark. Abraham, when God said, and you're going to see Abraham in this passage a couple of times, the very first act of faith in Abraham's life is when God said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to leave your father and mother. I want you to leave the world in which you know, and I want you to go somewhere that I will show you. I don't know about you, but for me, I usually need a map. I have been so spoiled to Google Maps. Why? Because we usually get on our phone or get in our cars and we'll type in where we're going, and then we become numb to everything around us because we're listening just to what that Google Map says. Abraham didn't have Google Maps, y'all. God just said, I'll tell you each and every step of the way. That is faith. And it's hope in tomorrow, being able to trust God, saying, I may not understand this, I may not know where He's taking me, but I have hope in the fact that tomorrow will be more fulfilling than today, because I am walking and I am trusting in God. Sarah, though she was barren, believed God. She laughed, but she believed. God again in Abraham's life tested him by saying, I want you to take your son, your only son, and I want you to go to the mountain, and there I want you to offer Isaac. Abraham trusted God. Not that this is good, that God's called me to something easy, by the way, but even in the hard decisions, when the steps that I take bring tears, I have hope and faith that God will accomplish his divine purpose in our life. Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Moses' parents, I'm sorry, then Moses. Then the nation of Israel, and what I think we need to understand is it's not just individual faith that moves out, but it's collective faith as well. Individually, we could take a faith test and whatever that might be, but I would be willing to bet that if there were 100 questions, we'd all score differently if that test existed. But then there are times that not only are we called as individuals to exercise and step out in faith, but we're called collectively as a group to follow God. The Israelites, the Red Sea, they trusted God, they crossed and it was dry. What happened to the army behind them, though? Not so well. You see, they weren't trusting in dry ground. They were trusting in God. The army trusted in dry ground. See, both walked on it. Don't miss this. Both groups walked on it, but they had faith in totally different directions. You know, there might be something to be said about that with us as churches all across this world, as they gather back together, and they do that with some degree of fear and trepidation. No one wants to get sick. We all want to be wise, but at some point, we have to begin to identify that this is not going to go away, and if we let this drive the church away, we're in trouble. Now, think about that for 1 second. This corona stuff is not going to go away. I believe in what I've read that this is a nuance that doctors are saying we might get a vaccine, we might get all these other things to help address it, but this is something that's going to be with you for a while. We can't let this something that's going to be with us for a while keep the church from being the church. And I'll be the first to admit, church is probably going to look different in the days and years ahead. But when you read the book of Acts, and you go to the very last chapter, and the very last sentence, and the very last word, you won't find a conclusion. Doesn't say amen. Doesn't say we're done. In fact, it doesn't end because the church is not over yet. Church looks different today than it did in the first century, and it's going to look way different, I believe, in our tomorrows. But the church must remain to be being the church, individually and corporately. So Hebrews 10 tells us, have confidence in your faith and hope. Then realize this, in chapter 11, we're talking about 21 individuals or people groups that did not have the Holy Spirit at work in their lives all the time. Understand this, and theologians have talked about this for a long time, and wherever you land on this is fine. But when God called Abraham, Abraham had to step out and trust God with what we call raw faith and raw hope. Why is it raw faith and raw hope? Because the time of the Holy Spirit had not come yet. See, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit was selective and temporary. The Holy Spirit would choose who he was going to work in, but it was never a permanent position of the life of that person that the Holy Spirit would indwell them. Why? Because it wasn't that time yet. Jesus in the New Testament comes and promises us the Helper, and the Helper comes, and when the moment you prayed to receive Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, guess what? You got the Spirit. So when you look at that, you are drawn to chapter 12, and it says this: therefore, since we are surrounded with such a great cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside all those things and the sin which makes us trip, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. And we fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, whom for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and now is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Hebrews chapter 10, we're encouraged to recognize the confidence. Hebrews chapter 11, we're encouraged to recognize the example laid before us. And then in Hebrews chapter 12, we're called to pick up the mantle and go. Don't forget that. Hebrews 10, find confidence. Confidence in your hope. God is worthy. He's faithful. Hebrews chapter 11, and look at all these examples of those that individually, to corporate groups, to nations. Again, I'll go back. From heroes to harlots to nations of people. We get an example of what it meant to follow God in the Old Testament. And then the author of Hebrews in the 12th chapter says, therefore, since we are surrounded with this great group of individuals behind us and the group before us, we know that we can do it. I want to share just one very brief story. And Linda, would you begin, please, if you don't mind? A guy named Jack Croft wrote this quite a few years ago, and I didn't think I was going to find it, but I found it on Wednesday morning. Jack's mother suffered a stroke, and he was living in Florida at the time, and they had a home up in Myrtle Beach. That was the family home. And Jack had a 4.5, 5-year-old daughter. And Jack's mom suffered a stroke. And he said the hardest thing he'd ever done that life had not prepared him for was to go and tell Amy that night as she crawled into bed, Amy, I've got to go see Grandma tomorrow. And he did the best that he could to explain that Grandma had something go on, and she's asleep. She's in a deep, deep sleep. And the doctors say she may not wake up. And again, with a brokenness and fear that surrounded him, he didn't know what to do or what to say. And Amy climbs in the bed, and she snuggles up under those covers, lays her head on that pillow, and she looks up with eyes blazing. And she said, well, Daddy, maybe Grandma will wake up. He had bought in to what the doctor said. He didn't know how to tell his daughter that you're hoping for the best, but sweetheart, you ought to expect the worst, and you need to realize that's life right there. He didn't say it. He got up to Myrtle Beach. And for a week, he and his brother cared for their mom. He and his brother and dad did everything they could to prepare to say those final goodbyes. A week led into two. 2 weeks led into three. And on the third week, what doctors and all their knowledge couldn't fix, what nothing in life explained away, Jack's mother opened her eyes. Now, she went through a year of rehabilitation. She went through a year of relearning how to do the simplest, from reading to walking to talking. The beauty of this story and the way it ends is this. Jack was forced to acknowledge this, that faith is not hoping for the best and expecting the worst. Faith and hope is being able to look at our world and the circumstances that surround us with all the joy and wonder of a child's hope. With a child's hope. Not many years later, Jack's mom naturally passed away. And as he performed his mom's funeral, he let Amy tell her story. What story are you going to tell the world today? Are we willing to see our circumstances through the face of a child and through hope that transcends every doubt we've ever had? Today, we have the chance to look fear in the face, to cause caution to take notice of us and see the world through the eyes of hope that only can be found in a child. Father, bless our vision. Give us the ability to see with your eyes. Give us the ability to smile at catastrophe with the hope of a child. Each person in this room and those that are listening at home all face different circumstances. All of us are years and years away from childhood, but draw us back that our hope and our faith would be as simple as that of a child. We ask in Christ's name.
How are you going to glorify him this week? Who are you going to share that hope with this week? That, I think, is a challenge for each and every one of us. As you go through this week, if there are some needs that you have, or in the course of sharing with others, you find out needs, please let us know. You can let me know on Sunday mornings. I'll make sure that gets added to the list. You can call the church office or email us. There are a lot of ways, but please let us know. We update our prayer list each Monday morning. We encourage you to join us for prayer time if you can as well. I also want to remind you, and Steve, if you can go ahead and put that next slide up, that as we're dismissed in just a moment, we're going to ask that you remain seated as always. We'll dismiss from the back, so just follow Bud or Eden's instructions, and they will dismiss you. As you are headed out, also remember that there are buckets at the doors for your tithes and offerings, that you can drop those there. Again, we want to thank you for joining us for worship this morning. And with that, I'm going to ask Linda and the play praise team to close us.
I'd like you to stand to sing. And as I reminded the worship team this morning, this song is not necessarily about seeing each other in heaven, but it's seeing each other next week and this week. So sing, God be with you till we meet again. See those of you online again. See you.